Okay, so here the next our check is shear buckling resistance of web. So for thin web, it is necessary to check the shear resistance of web for the buckling. So resistance to shear buckling shall be verified when d by tw ratio which is greater than 67e for web without the stiffeners, and d by tw ratio which is greater than 67e under root kV by 5.35 for wave with the stiffener. So here it provides in IS 800-2007, clause number 8.4.2, page number 59. So kV is equal to shear buckling coefficient, which is 5.35 when the transverse stiffeners are provided only at the supports, right? And other criteria is also given. So next is the buckling of a wave plate. So the shear strength of a plate girder depends upon the d by tw ratio. The webs of the plate girders are usually stiffened by the transverse intermediate stiffeners, and this helps to increase the ultimate shear resistance of the web. So the shear capacity of the web has two components, namely strength before the onset of buckling and the strength after the buckling. So the nominal shear strength governed by the buckling may be studied and evaluated from the following behavior of web plate, which is a pre-buckling behavior of the web plate and the post-buckling behavior of the web plate. The first of all is talking about the pre-buckling behavior of the web plate. So the shear force in the web plate produces buckling of a plate. So a thin web plate subjected to shear shearing stresses it on it in its own plate is shown in the figure 4.4a. The square element in the plate experiences principal tensile stresses along the diagonal AC and the principal compressive stresses along the diagonal BD. So as the applied loading is incrementally increased, the corresponding shear stress also increases and the plate will buckle along the direction of compressive diagonal BD. So the compressive stress can cause local buckling, and as a result of plate develops a wave perpendicular to them. So the plate will lose the capacity of any further increase in the compressive stresses. Right? So the corresponding shear stresses in a plate is called elastic critical shear stress, which is known as a tau CR. So it basically depends on the boundary conditions, spacing of stiffeners, thickness of web. So since it is different to access the boundary conditions due to restraint offer the flanges and stiffeners, simply supported boundary conditions are assumed on the safer side. So the elastic critical shear stress in such a case is given in page number 16, which is tau CR is equal to kV pi square E divided by 12, 1 minus mu square, d by tw raised to square. Right? Here, mu is equal to Poisson's ratio, kV is equal to shear buckling coefficient, E is equal to modulus of elasticity of steel. So it is equal to 2 multiplied by 10 to 5 Newton per mm squared. So elastic critical shear stress, which is tau CR, may be significantly increased by providing intermediate transverse stiffeners and providing longitudinal stiffeners. So second is a post-buckling behavior of wave plate. So the first stage of the shear resistance by the wave plate till the attain its elastic critical stress has been explained in the previous articles. So after the wave buckles along the direction of a principal compressive stress, a new load carrying mechanism is created along the principal tensile direction. So a new mechanism is called as a tension field action. So any further increase in the shear load is resisted by the tension field action. So the tensile field consists of the portion of the plate in a tensile direction and anchored at boundaries along the top and the bottom flanges, and the stiffeners on the side of the web panel. So figure 4.5a, at this stage, the total stress in the web plate is composed of the applied critical shear stress. And when the web plates buckle, the post-buckle membrane tensile stress due to tension field action. So the state of stress at this stage is shown in figure, can be obtained by resolving the stress in the direction along and perpendicular to the direction to the angle of inclination phi, right? So the nominal shear strength of a wave, which is Vn is equal to Vcr, may be calculated by one of the following two methods, which is simple post-critical method and tension field method. So first is the simple post-critical method. So this method is general method and can be applied to a design of all the girders. So it is basically based on the shear buckling strength of webs. So this method can be used for webs of I section girders with or without intermediate transfer stiffness, provided the web has a transfer stiffness at supports. So the nominal shear strength is given by Bn is equal to Vcr, and here Vcr is equal to Av into tau b, which is the shear force corresponding to the web buckling, right? So first is when the lambda w, which is less than or equal to 0.8, then the tau b is equal to F by w divided by under root 3. Second is when the lambda w is between 0.8 to 1.2, then the tau b value is in bracket 1 minus 0.8 lambda w minus 0.8 into F by w divided by under root 3. The third case is when the lambda w value is greater than or equal to 1.2, then the tau b is equal to F by w divided by under root 3 gamma lambda square w. So here lambda w is equal to non-dimensional wave slenderness ratio for the shear buckling stress. And equation of this is equal to under root F by w divided by under root 3 tau cr. Here tau cr is equal to elastic critical shear stress of the web, which is kV pi square e divided by 12 into 1 minus mu square d by tw square. So here mu is equal to Poisson's ratio, and for the steel, its value is mu is equal to 0.3. So kV is equal to 5.135 when the transfer stiffness are provided only at supports. Now next is the tension field method. This method of finding shear buckling strength of the web is based on the post-buckling strength. So this method may be used if ends and intermediate transfer stiffness are provided. If as the web begins to buckle, right, so it loses the ability to resist diagonal compression. So as this stretch, transfer stiffness and the flanges come into action to resist diagonal compression. So the vertical components of this compression is resisted by transfer stiffness and the horizontal component by the flanges. As you can see in this figure, so the web resists only diagonal tension. So Vn is equal to Vtf, which is provided in a page number 16, clause number 8.4.2.2p. So here Vtf equation is equal to Av tau b plus 0.9 Wtf Twf b sine phi, which is less than or equal to Vt. Here tau b is equal to buckling strength as obtained in a simple post-critical method. Fv is equal to yield strength of the tension field. Chi is equal to 1.5 tau b sine 2 tau 2 phi, and phi is equal to inclination of the tension field. And the phi equation is equal to tan inverse d by c. Here Wtf is equal to width of tension field. Fy is equal to yield stress of the web. D is equal to depth of the web. C is equal to spacing of the stiffness in the web. Tau b is equal to shear stress corresponding to the buckling of web. And Sc and Sc is the anchor length of tension fields along the compression and the tension fringes, right? Now, design of the end panels. So, in the code, clause number 8.5.1, which permits the design of end panels both by the simple post-critical methods and tension field actions. Right. So first one is the end panel design using a simple post-critical method. So when the interior panel A in the girder is designed using tension field action, the end panel B shall be designed using simple post-critical method. So in this case, end panels along with the stiffener should be checked as a beam spanning between the flanges to resist the shear force RTF and the moment MTF due to the tension field action as given in clause number 8.5.3. So apart from this, the end stiffener should be capable of resisting the end reactions plus compression forces due to moments which is equal to the MTF. So second case is end panels designed using tension field action, which is given in clause number 8.5.2. So here, if the end panels is also designed using tension field action, it should be provided with an end post which is consisting of a single or double stiffener. So for single stiffness, the top of the end post should be rigidly connected to the flange using the full strength weld. The end post should be capable of resisting a reaction plus moment from the anchor forces equal to 2/3 of MTF due to tension field forces. The width or thickness of the end posts are not exceed the width and the thickness of the flanges. Now next is a double stiffener. Where the double stiffeners are provided in the end panels, the end post should be checked as a beam spanning between the flanges of the girder and the capable of resisting of a shear force RTF and the moment PF due to the tension field forces. Next is the anchor forces. So the resultant of longitudinal shear RTF and the moment from the anchor tension field forces are evaluated as below. So RTF equation is equal to HQ by 2 and MTF is equal to HQ into D by 10. So here VP is equal to DT F by under root 3. So if the actual factor shear force V in the panel design using tension field action is less than the shear strength VTF as given in clause number 8.4.2.2b, then the value of HQ may be reduced by this ratio is equal to V minus VCR divided by VTF minus VCR. Here VTF is equal to basic shear strength of the panel and VCR is equal to critical shear strength for the panel. Now next is the design bearing stiffener. So in case of roll stress section, the waves are so proportional that it can carry load without buckling or crippling of web. But in case of plate girders, to achieve the economic, webs are made thin. So in such cases, stiffeners are required at the end to transfer the reaction safely. So stiffener may also require at the point of concentrated loads acting at some points on the girder. So the function of bearing stiffener is to prevent the local crushing of the wave due to the concentrated loading. So bearing stiffener should be provided for the webs where the force applied to a flange by the loads or the reaction exceeds local capacity of the wave. So here the local capacity of the wave is Fw is equal to V1 plus N2 or Tw Fy by gamma M0. It's provided in page number 67. So Fw is equal to local capacity of web. V1 is equal to stiff bearing length. N2 is equal to length obtained by dispersion through the flange to the wave junction at a slope of 1 gem 2.5 to the plane of the flange. Tw is equal to thickness of wave and Fyw is equal to yield stress of the wave. So here the bearing stiffener should be checked for buckling resistance, bearing capacity, torsional resistance. So first is the buckling resistance of stiffener. So buckling resistor stiffener should be based on the design compressive stress of a strut, radius of gyration being taken about the axis parallel to the web. So the effective section is the full area or core area of the stiffeners together with an effective length of wave on each side of the center line of the stiffener, which is limited to 20 TW. So buckling resistance may be found explained below, which is a find area of effective section. So the effective section is a full area or core area of stiffener together with an effective length of wave on each side of the center line of the wave on each side of the center line of the stiffener, which is limited to 20 TW, right? So it means that R is equal to radius of gyration and equation is equal to under root I by A. KL is equal to 0.7 L. And from the table 9C, which is provided in page number 42, the buckling resistance is equal to FQD is equal to FCD multiplied by A, which is greater than applied load. So outstand of a wave stiffener from the face of the wave should not exceed 20 TQE when the outstand is between 14 TQE and the 20 TQE. The stiffener design should be the basic of core section with an outstand of 14 TQE, where the TQE is equal to thickness of the stiffener. Second check is a bearing check. So load carrying wave stiffener should also be a sufficient size that bearing strength of the stiffeners given below is not less than the load transfer. It means that FPS is equal to AQFY divided by 0.8 gamma M0, which is greater than or equal to Fx. Here Fx is equal to external load, AQ is equal to area of stiffeners, and Fy is equal to yield stress for the stiffeners. Third check is for torsional resistance. So where the bearing stiffeners are required to provide torsional restraints at the supports of the beam, they should meet the following criteria, which is the second moment of area of the stiffener section about the central line of the web, IS should be such that IS greater than or equal to 0.34 alpha S d cube TCF. Here, alpha S is equal to 0.006 for LLT by RY less than or equal to 50, right? So here, all types of criteria is given. Next is the design of intermediate transfer web stiffener. So for design requirement, the intermediate transfer stiffener may be provided on one or both sides of the web. The spacing of the intermediate stiffeners depends upon the ratio d by dw, and the outstand of stiffener should not be more than 20 TQE, right? And the minimum stiffeners. There are buckling check on intermediate transverse web stiffeners, right? Stiffeners not subjected to external loads or moment should be checked for the stiffener forces. So FQ is equal to V minus VCR divided by gamma M0, which is less than or equal to FQD. Here, FQD is equal to design resistance of the intermediate stiffeners. V is equal to factor shear force, and VCR is equal to shear buckling resistance of the web panel. So there is a design connection between the flange and the wave plate. So V is equal to shear force, which is acting on the section. So shear stress at the junction QW equation is equal to V into AF Y bar divided by IZB. Horizontal shear forces per unit length QW is equal to V into AF Y bar divided by 2IZ on one side of the web. So here AF is equal to area of flange, Y bar is equal to distance of CG of the flange, and IZ is equal to MI of the girder section. So here P should be greater than QW, and minimum size of plate shall as per table number 21, page number 78, an intermittent field bed may also be provided with the effective length not less than 4S or 40 mm, whichever is more. And the clear spacing between the effective length of intermittent fillet field shall not be exceed 12 T for compression and 16 T for tension. So there is a design. Design of connection between load bearing stiffeners and the web. Right. So there are the steps are also provided. So here at the end. Our main steps involved in the design of plates are, first is loading. So assume the self weight of the girder, which is equal to the total factor load divided by 200 kN per meter. So the total UDL is equal to dead load plus live load plus self weight of the girder. Second step is finding out the self weight and bending moment calculation. The third step is the section selection, which is determine the optimum depth of girders by relation D is equal to MK by FY raised to 0.33. So K is equal to D by DW. Here, if D by DW, which is less than or equal to 67 A, when the low end stiffeners and intermediate transverse stiffeners are required. And for D by DW, equal to or near to 100, intermediate transverse stiffeners are not required. Right? Only the end stiffeners are required. So step 4 is going to check for the minimum web thickness requirement, which is given in page number 63. Fifth step is to check for moment capacity equation of MD is equal to beta B ZP FY by gamma M0, which is provided in page number 53. We also see these checks in the previous different types of examples or design in another chapter. Right, so you can familiar with this equation. The second step is the sixth step is check for shear capacity. It is also calculated in the previous chapter, which is VD is equal to AB FY by under root 3 gamma M0, which is provided in page number 59. So seventh step is check for shear buckling of wave using a simple post critical method, which means VN is equal to VCR. So here VCR is equal to AB tau B. Here if the CR VCR greater than B, so the intermediate transverse stiffeners are not required. If the VCR less than B, then the intermediate transverse stiffeners are required to improve the buckling strength or the slender wave. Step 8 is check for anchor forces in the end panels. So this check is required when the intermediate transverse stiffeners are provided. Step 9 is to design end bearing stiffeners. Step 10 is design of intermediate transverse stiffeners if required. Step 11 is the design of connection between the web plate and the flange. And the last step is the design for connection between stiffeners and web. So here we complete our chapter is the design of plate girders.